my family is a tremendous storytelling family. It's basically the culture of my grandfather and my father, myself and my brothers, and now my children. They're even more infected with it than I ever was. So storytelling is this fundamental gift in human nature. It is the way we pass down to the coming generations and share with each other often very hard-won bits of wisdom. This is grace, maybe a natural grace or a supernaturally given but a naturally incorporated grace in human nature. Truth, a living truth, passed through the human filter, if you will. But in essence, a word of truth made flesh in a particular and unique way. That is a story. Irish people are also very long-winded. That was just the preamble to what I would like to tell you. The cosmic significance of small events. I think most of us would agree that to some degree, the current state of Western civilization has flattened down our perceptions of the actual shape, the form of the created order, of existence itself, really. We're living in a somewhat flattened cosmology. We live in an incredibly powerful, incredibly rich civilization that rewards us at every turn for the perceptions and the choices of materialism. It is a kind of a flat land, but one like a river, a mile wide and an inch deep. We are capable of astonishing things in the modern era. But we have lost touch with fundamental human things, by and large. The things that make us human. The things that reflect back to He who is our Father Creator. And these fundamental things are universal to all mankind, regardless of race, culture, time, and history. I first experienced this, first had a kind of an awakening about these beautiful springs at the heart of human nature, hidden springs, very hidden in our times. When I was 12 years old, our family went to live in the Canadian Arctic, actually a very high region of the Arctic, very close to the North Pole. On the Arctic Ocean, a small Eskimo Inuit village of 200 people living at a very primitive level. In the early 1960s, life was still very primitive in many communities in the North. There were about 20 white people in our village, my family being one of them. My father was the government administrator. He'd been a bush pilot and fallen in love with the North many years ago. And in 1961, he took my mother and my brothers and my sister and I to live there. And I can remember a conversation we had, my dad and I, after the news had been broken that we were going to move to the Arctic. We lived in a suburb of Ottawa, a fairly modern city. And he came home and my parents told us we were going to live in a very simple, very remote place. And all of us, you know, ever open to an adventure, we instantaneously said, oh, that's fantastic, an adventure. Oh, something new, something exciting. And I, being the eldest of the family, and far more prudent, raised an objection. I said to my father, but Dad, is there a television in the Arctic? And he said, sorry, son, there's no television reception in the Arctic. This was unthinkable, because at that stage of our life, we were very much devoted to Howdy Doody and Ed Sullivan. Many of you don't know who that is, but the early days of television, we were the first generation of media addicts. But it was black and white and pretty clean stuff. But we were addicted. We could not imagine life without our addiction. And like all addicts, we thought life was the addiction, or felt it was. From the moment we arrived in the Arctic, in a noisy little ski plane that had flown for hours and hours and hours north, straight north from Yellowknife, Northwest Territories, above a vast, vast ocean, an infinite ocean of white, into a kind of radical reduction of existence, which I was to learn was a radical expansion of vision about existence. That was to come later. We landed in the middle of winter in January in a tiny community in this vast sea of white. Most of the buildings, the residences, were igloos or small shacks banked with snow for insulation. This whole new world opened up for us. From the moment our feet hit the snow, we entered a new world and never looked back. It was like coming alive. And I can honestly say for 3 years, I did not give television a thought, did not hanker after it. Of course, there'd been about a 2-week withdrawal period getting to the north. But life became, I'm oversimplifying it by calling it more real. But in a sense, it was a mode of life that was more real. We saw birth for the first time, the birth of human beings. We saw nursing mothers for the first time. All the mothers in our little tiny mission church nursed without covering. This was very fascinating for 12-year-old boys. But in some way very pure and very moving. One little life deriving his or her life from the life of another. We saw, to begin to tell you stories about that life, those three plus years in the Arctic, I wouldn't stop and I wouldn't really get to the point I want to make here tonight. Suffice it to say, it was our first experience that there is a bigger universe than the very big and very powerful urban environment, which is the place the overwhelming majority of modern men live. Man has become urban man. And the city, albeit many cities have been beautified and humanized, especially the older European cities, they do function as magnificent large machines, kind of meta-machines, in many of their aspects. And this has consequences and effects. We were given the immense privilege, my brothers and my sister and I, of being removed from that environment for a time during extremely important formative years. Our friends, our own ages, did not have a word of English. We did not speak or understand a word of their language, Inuktitut. But here, because of necessity, and because of perhaps the lack of intuitions of youth, the enthusiasms of youth, these language barriers, this effect of the Tower of Babel, dissolved very quickly. We learned, each of us, the Inuit children and the Irish children, Irish-Canadian children, a few words of each other's language. But the primary language that we developed was a language of the heart, that universal language which is embedded deep within us, which makes it possible for us to reach out and touch, or at least to see in people of radically alien cultures, to see our own face looking back at us, our own selves, really. So beautiful friendships and shared adventures resulted from this. Then our first summer in the Arctic came. The snow melted sometime in early June. It was all gone. But the sea itself, which freezes 4 to 8 feet deep in that part of the Arctic Ocean, did not melt right away. But for about a month, it began to dissolve. And it didn't go the way ice goes here in our climates. It was so deep, the sun could not melt it, turn it into water fast enough. What it did was, it turned into these spear-like crystals, and the process, the scientific name for it is called candling. The whole ice shelf, this immense partial continent of ice, turned into crystal chandeliers and began to tinkle. It was the most amazing thing. I've never heard anything like it since. And beautiful sound. At the same time, the sun was staying in the sky longer and longer each day. End of June, the sun did not set. All of which was tremendous liberation for us all. You know, to live in a world where the sun never set was really quite a marvel. The world was full of marvels, full of them at every turn. Perhaps because it was all new to us. But we did have this profound experience of experiencing another world, an alternative world. One must have been July day because all the sea ice had finally melted. One day in July, we had a kayak, a long caribou, sealskin covered kayak over willow wood. My parents wisely let my brother and I nearly drown in it a few times. It was very good for our souls. But we didn't drown, and we learned to master it. We had a dog team. We learned to master the dog team. Just all these new relationships with creation, new skills, new knowledge, imperfectly exercised, imperfectly learned, but all of which teaching at a deep level, the world is bigger than you think or you have been formed to think it is. And beyond that, the universe itself, the created universe, is bigger still. And beyond the material universe, the immensity of the realm of the eternal, the realm of the Father, Son, and Spirit, is unthinkably beyond that as well. And because we have only limited perception or have in our limited experience not seen, tasted, felt that eternal sweet fire, does not mean it is not there. And this was one of the valuable lessons of learning that one's concept of reality itself is tragically stunted. And then to experience something bigger, a tremendous gift. So this one July morning, it might have been 2 a.m, the sun was up, and so I couldn't sleep, and it was just so glorious to be set free from all the laws of nature that we had been raised with. So I got up and went down to the shore, and there was the kayak sitting there with its 12-foot-long paddle, an extremely long kayak paddle, because it was an extremely long kayak. It wasn't like our modern racing kayaks. And it was as narrow as a spear, and it would shoot across the water like a spear, like an arrow. It was so beautiful, that boat. So by whatever impulse drove me, who knows what impulses drive the young, I realized the only thing to do at this moment was to get in that kayak and go out to sea, which I did. And just magnificent feeling of liberation. But the headwind came up, and so I diverted, had to traverse the waves so as not to capsize, and went at an angle along the shore until I came to a river that drained the barren lands into the Arctic Ocean. And then I crossed the mouth of the river And I came to a place which I had already been in winter on foot across the ice. And it was the home of an elderly couple who lived there. I can still remember their names. Their names were James and Annie Quailhoch. And, it's so strange. The modern age is so strange. 40 years later, I went on the internet. Last year, I went on the internet and typed in the name of the village. It's no longer 200 people. It's 2,000 plus. And the name of the high school, there was never a high school there when I was there, the name of the high school is James Quailhoch High School. It's just so strange. But anyway, I digress. Coming back, child in a boat crossing a river, landing on these pebbled beaches and climbing up through the moss, and all the shorebirds and nesting birds in the moss, screaming and crying with many different cries, wildflowers. The north, which we think of as a barren land, in summertime is an explosion of beauty. Flowers, a vast multitude of wildflowers, flower, seed, and they have to in a very short period of time. So there's this incredible symphony continuously on the visual level, the level of color, very colorful in the summer. So I'm walking up through all this splendor and glory to a caribou skin tent, which is up on the heights of the land, maybe 100 feet from shore. And I know that James and Annie live there. And the primary rule of the Arctic is, the social rule is hospitality. In my day, no one ever knocked on a door, mostly because there weren't doors, but they didn't have that etiquette. You entered anyone's home and could expect to be fed food and tea, usually. And so we had learned this rather beautiful new custom. My mother wasn't rather fond of that custom, but we loved it. So I knew that we would be welcomed by these people with whom we had no common language, but with whom we had established some kind of mysterious union. They told us their names were, we knew their Christian names, but they told us that we must call them Atatiok, which we later learned meant grandfather, and Ananatiok, which means grandmother. So this is what our names for them were. So I entered, I pulled back the flap on this very, very primitive tent. The smell of rotting fish flesh, seal flesh, dog droppings all around the tent. Not a disgusting smell at that point. We'd been acclimatized to say, this is the smell of reality. This is the smell of primitive life everywhere on this planet. It's humble. It's part of the human condition. It was not disgusting. These were, by contemporary standards, poor people. They had no cell phones. We could only use the voice. So I coming up the hill, I shouted, Ananatiok, grandmother. So I heard a voice, which is kind of, come, you know, ee. And so I just pulled the flap back and went inside, and expecting, in the confidence of youth, to be loved, to be welcomed, because they had already shown me love and total, absolute welcome. She had no teeth. She was close to 80, I would think, a woman dressed in a very simple calico parka, who bathed, if she ever bathed, maybe once a year in the middle of summer in the shallows of the river. But all the intelligence, the natural intelligence that is man's inheritance in those eyes, a lifetime of struggle and suffering, of bearing children, of bearing with a difficult husband, of loving, of giving life. Her smile, which was radiant, ugly, technically speaking, but very beautiful, was instantaneous light greeting me. And of course, it evoked the same response in me. Always the young, sophisticated, civilized young person, myself, desired to communicate with the crude instruments of spoken language. That's how we're formed. And I have no argument with it, but it is not the only language of man. But I was learning. I was learning to sit still. I was learning to observe, learning to be silent. This silence is perhaps the most difficult thing we have to learn in the modern age, which makes it increasingly difficult for us to learn it. We are afraid of silence. We're afraid of uncomfortable conversational gaps, aren't we? And most people are. I am still. We're afraid of dead airspace in the media. Ah, and isn't it interesting how the dominant element of contemporary life is the new media. New media. Films, videos, radio, television. Communication. Communication that cannot bear more than a few seconds of dead airspace. Because it does not understand about the living space, the living presence in silence. If I were to stand here in silence for the next 20 minutes, we'd all become very uncomfortable, and probably properly so. Annie did not speak to me with words. She smiled, and she continued. She took a big handful of Hudson's Bay Company tea, really raw black tea leaves, threw it into a boiling pot sitting on top of a twig fire. There's no trees in the north. There's no chopped down firewood, and smiled, and I learned we were going to wait for tea. We were just going to be together. And so I sat. It was a strange new feeling to just be with another person, not doing something, not producing something. Now, interestingly, Annie herself, and Nanatsiak, was doing something. But not in the sense that we think of doing something, not in the sense of productivity, utilitarian productivity. She was carving a piece of stone. She was a little bit of a stone carver. You may know that Inuit art is now a very highly prized, sophisticated art collected all over the world because of its power as visual language. And it's great beauty. It's great beauty. But at that stage, it was little known. In the very early 60s, it was little known in the world and only just gradually becoming known in Canada and beyond, in the States. And so the Inuit artists were just simply making things they had always made. Annie was carving a lump of black soapstone about this big, 8-10 inches long, and it was kind of an ovoid form. And I looked closer to see what she was making. And it was a man wrestling with a polar bear. It was very clearly that, but extremely, extremely beautiful forms and elegant design. Untrained, totally untrained artist, just instinctively creating this material word out of the depths of her heart and soul. Now, in the North, men do not wrestle with polar bears. You know, in those such encounters, men always lose. So, what was this about? Was this a literal depiction of a tragic event? Perhaps. But if you look at the full spectrum of Inuit work, what you see is a highly metaphorical language, a language of heart and soul that may have a literal dimension to it at times, often does, but is always, almost always, evoking something deeper, farther, higher, some reaching for the mysterious and often elusive world of meaning. Meaning. I do not mean meaning in terms of data or rational concepts, but the mysterious meaning that is at the roots of life itself. I think now, it took me decades to even reflect again on that image, which I took at the time to be only a literal thing, that on some level of her heart, she was making visible an interior understanding, an interior word. She was making flesh about man's condition in existence. It was about man facing overwhelming odds. It was about the human person, the human spirit. Even when all appears to be lost, all is not lost. Man, within his being, struggles against adversity, not with pure animal self-preservation, but with something far deeper, connected to the infinite and the eternal. This is a kind of art that is implicitly religious. It's about the spirit of man. It's about the image of God within man. Which is why I think if you cast your eyes about world art, you know, practically of any time and any place in this world, you will see the artists of a rather startling variety of cultures and peoples exploring the basic religious questions of man. Who am I? What am I? Where am I? What is this mystifying, unspeakably beautiful, and very dangerous place where I live? All peoples ask these basic questions. And through them, other questions, larger questions. Where am I going? What am I for? Am I going anywhere? The great questions. And so this woman, this little event, a boy has a cup of tea in a tent on the shore of an ocean and watches an old woman carve a piece of stone. Despite its exotic setting, it could easily have slipped from memory, and believe me, for many years it did, until my mother gave me the actual carving and I remembered. The carving, the actual object which a human hand and human heart had labored over, had perhaps bled on, had come forth from the material of her own experience, her own love, her own weakness, her own strengths. Here was this word. Cast beyond the limitations of her own years. Passed down. Passed down to a family that did not really understand it. But with the mercy of time and reflection and silence, began to ponder what the word might mean. Our world is very complex, as I said before. Magnificent, awesome, nearly godlike in its many powers. Dangerously Luciferian godlike in some of its powers. The speed at which we live permits little space for silence, almost no space for the contemplative dimension, which is one of the greatest treasures of human nature. A treasure of natural law within our created being, which illuminated by grace becomes holy contemplation, union with God, the restoration with the image and likeness of God. How little time we give to this, to simply gaze upon the face of a child, the face of an older person, purified by experience and suffering and love. How little time to listen. We are rewarded at every turn in this world for not listening, for not standing still in silence and waiting. We are rewarded immensely. No other race at any time in the entire history of the human race has been so bombarded with stimuli. Visceral stimuli, visually, mentally, auditorially, on every level of our senses. Rewarded, rewarded, rewarded by mega stimuli that keeps us racing. And yet, we must ask, why are we the most depressed people in the history of mankind? Why are such vast numbers of people on antidepressant medicines? Why are so many young people, these beautiful and vital young people with the full inheritance of humanity, simply taking their own lives in unprecedented numbers? In this richest, most blessed of all civilizations. I need not answer that here. I think it points to the fact that we are not living in a way that is fully human, and that we must get back to very simple things, simple basic things. And primary among those is to stop the pace at which we live for a time and ponder what may be more human paces. We are driven by what we perceive to be necessities for survival, either highly complex economic necessities or highly complex emotional necessities. I say, and I have a scandalous thing to say here tonight, I think we should try experiencing failure more often. I think our obsession with success, achievement, is a kind of utilitarianism, and it can often be masked by religious utilitarianism, at least a tacit or practical religious utilitarianism. We do not pray enough. Personally, I rush into the Blessed Sacrament Chapel, throw myself on my knees, straining to be contemplative, straining to give God an hour of my life, maybe once a week. And what I get is interior noise. Why is God not speaking to me? Why is God not dealing with all my interior noise, my many, many worries, my concerns, my children's personalities, everything, you know, all those things that afflict a parent's heart? How am I going to survive in my work? Look at the world, it's such a mess. Blah, 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 to the Lord. God. And what does our Father in heaven do? He waits for us. It's a perfectly consistent pattern. I may have analyzed it wrong, but this is what I get. He waits for us until we've just simply run out of blather. And he lets us feel the poverty of our creaturehood. The fact that we are not God, you know, in this Promethean age, with its many stolen fires, the very best medicine for all of us is to feel that we are very little children, beloved children, beloved, very little. To come before God through Jesus, to come before the Holy Trinity in weakness and that much not sought after precious gift of failure. All my best lessons in life have been taught to me through radical weakness and radical failure. And from that has come the fruit, the good fruit. But first I had to learn the essential lesson. Be still and know that He is God. Be still and know that He is God. But we are blind. We are blind and deafened by the noise of this age, and we are not reading the languages which God is speaking to us continually. He is speaking. He's speaking in a way that's calling us to attention before His presence. He's not speaking to us in a way, at least outside of sacred scripture and the teachings of the church, he's not speaking to us in a way that simply gives us more religious information to pack into our brains. He is speaking heart to heart. He is speaking father to child through his son who died for us. Died for us so that we could come to a state of attention before the truth of reality. How little attention we give to him. We can know this in the mind and not know it in the heart. This problem of language is not about words, concepts in the mind. It is about the flow of reality in creation. And one of the first teachers of the presence of alternative languages is nature itself. Now, on certain glorious days in autumn, there's always a temptation for even really devout Christians to become pantheists, I say. But a short-lived temptation, but still hard to resist at times. But he is there in terms of he is its creator, he is the artist who made this glory all around us. Now, my wife and I live extremely, extremely busy lives. We have for 30 years, my life as a writer, editor, artist, trying to raise 6 children in a double income, no kids society, economy, anti-life society, editor of a magazine, always taking on more and more and more things because the harvest is great, the laborers are few. Too much, too much, too much, spread too thin, trying to do too much, and so expanding the sphere of activity and losing the foundation, the interior stillness, attention, union with Christ, from which all fruitful actions can flow. Which is another long-winded way of saying, I didn't have enough time for my wife. We didn't have enough time for each other. We were homeschooling our children for 20 years, added on to everything else. But we learned after a few years that if we did not communicate in the sense of having at least half an hour together, just us, of presence. We didn't have to talk. We didn't have to download all the day's crises. God knows every day had them. We loved each other very much, still do. Happy marriage, normal struggles, but no time. No time, no time for love. For heart-soul love. For attention. We were busy doing many godly things. And so we began to spring a few normal, the usual kind of leaks. And at that point, we sat down, had a good talk together, and said, we need to spend time together, just us. Because our entire lives have become filling other people's needs, and rightly so. So we made a decision to walk every day. Rain, snow, sleet, blizzard, tsunami, whatever it was, we were going to walk together, side by side, down a backcountry road. We live fairly far out in the country, in northern Ontario, a place that looks very much like the mountains of Vermont. 3 young Philadelphians have visited us there. So am I being accurate or exaggerating? Yeah, it's a gloriously beautiful place. But we'd stop looking at it because we were so doggone busy. We'd stop looking at it. We didn't see it. We just lived in it. We lived in the machine, a machine which we carried in our own heads, the creatures of our society. We stopped looking, stopped listening. So I remember about 2-3 years ago, we were on one of our daily walks, and sometimes we'd talk and we'd share tremendously exciting ideas, or sometimes we'd chew on the children's struggles and this or that problem, but it was all good. It was really good stuff. And sometimes we'd just hold hands and walk for an hour. You know, clear out the arteries, clear out the brain. Unitive, but non-talkative. Well, this one day, I had stumbled upon St. Augustine's treatise on Christian doctrine, and there came upon the most astounding little passage, which seemed to me not to have too much to do with Christian doctrine. It seemed to me he'd just simply articulated my whole life as an artist. It was a section on word and sign, on the meaning of language. And what this old Roman father of the church, this old sinner who became this incredible teacher of the church, had to tell us about the word made flesh with such brilliance, such clarity, has not been surpassed since then. Perhaps John Paul II and a few other thinkers like this have articulated and brought it farther. But there it is. There it is. The whole theology, if you will, of existence as language, as God speaking to us, and human language deriving from that. What are words? What are symbols? What are signs? Now, I had read this thing the day before. I was so excited because what I'd been coming to intuitively, non-rationally, these understandings of these truths through simply doing the work, simply creating and praying as I created, and struggling and making mistakes in my art and working, etc., etc., all had come about it crawling through the darkness at ground level, coming upon this incredible articulation of exactly what I'd been taught the hard way. So anyway, oh dear, more prologues. I mean to say that I was incredibly excited by this discovery, for me, which was entirely new. And so I was walking along with my wife, and I was vehemently, in happy vehemence, extrapolating on this discovery. I said, Augustine, he saw it. He saw it 1,600 years ago, 1,500 years ago. Blah, 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 blah. I said, Sheila, it's all of creation is radiant with God speaking to us. It's not God, but it was made by him, and he's speaking to us through it. And it's so beautiful, so beautiful, but we're blind. And I was going on rather at length about this. And she was smiling and nodding and putting in a few insights of her own. And I said, it's as if we're so blind, but creation is continually pouring out miracles. It's as if fabulous birds are raining out of the skies and we don't see it. The moment I said, fabulous birds are raining out of the skies, throwing my arms wide in a melodramatic gesture of intensity, there was a flash of blue at the end of my hand. I mean, that second, not perceived before because it was hidden by a bush or a railing or something. I hadn't seen it. Fabulous birds falling from the sky, flash of blue, just like that. But it was of a kind of blue that I had never seen before. That certainly struck me, even though it was in my peripheral vision. So we both stopped and said, look. So we went over, and there was a fabulous bird that had fallen out of the sky. And not an ostrich or a peacock, and it was a very small little bird, actually one called the indigo bunting. I don't know if you have it down here. Do you have indigo buntings? They're very little. You have them, yes. Well, there's no blue like it. And there's some kind of genius in whoever designed this creature. Because not only is it its form extremely beautiful, extremely elegant, both function and form in perfect balance, you know, it's not like the dodo bird or the penguin. It's just elegant, elegant, elegant little songbird. And as you say, the colors of a blue that I don't think we could invent it. And what happens in its feathers is also quite startling. It begins with a kind of unique turquoise in the head, and the color spectrum slides without any noticeable, perceptible change through the spectrum of blue to dark indigo, a very dark blue. I said, who designed this? Where did this come from? And my wife said, and it was dead. It had, and it was still warm. It was warm in our hands. So it had died maybe a few minutes before, maybe hit by a car, I don't know. Didn't have any damage on it. So my wife said something reflective. She said, and so death entered the world. My wife is not a morbid person. I'm the morbid member of the family. Being Irish and melancholic. But it was a deep reflection. This glory, this beautiful created glory, had died. And if we were to leave it there on the road, it would rot and all its structure, molecular structure, would disintegrate. And it would be no more. And yet, as a little living word, it would have lived in us, in our memory. It lives now in our memory. And notice, if you will, that I've just passed on that little living word to you. I have spoken a word which is merely the vibration of air. I have told a very little story. Man finds a dead bird on the side of the road. I realize this is not Homer's Odyssey. But I have told you a story, very little story. And now that little blue bird, perhaps, it will come to your minds from time to time. Perhaps the meaning of it will seem odd or insignificant or highly significant or not, but it will be there in you. The air from my lungs which created that vibration has dissipated. The vibration has ceased. Your eardrums have ceased vibrating, but the word that was in my heart and my memory now lives in your heart and memory. This is certainly one dimension of culture. There's more at work here. There's more at work in the telling of stories than merely passing images back and forth to each other. We are also giving to each other intimations and evocations of a larger presence in the universe. We were, to return to my story, which is not yet over, I said, this is amazing, I want to take this little bird home. She said, oh yes, we should show the children for biology class, homeschooling biology class, which we did. I put it in my pocket, took it home. But on our way home, we began to talk about, I began to talk more about this incredible coincidence, maybe a little thing in the world, a coincidence. Maybe not a coincidence, who knows. But we began to get really excited about it and kind of drifted into the what we knew about the symbols of Christ in creation. So we of course, came to the great white stag, which was very, very well known in medieval symbology. The symbol of the church, the pelican, striking blood from her own breast to feed her chicks. The kingfisher bird, who raises his young at sea in the middle of winter, built upon the Greek myth of the halcyon, but baptized by Christ as a symbol of Christ, raising his children in adversity. The kingfisher bird. What are the other symbols? I can't remember now. But anyway, we were waxing enthusiastic, went home, and had the rest of our normal evening and day evening. We were pretty tired, put the kids to bed, sat down, and we had our idea of a great date. Our idea of a great date is to get into bed early, to read a mystery novel, to chat, and to go to sleep at 9 o'clock at night. That's, to us, that's a great date. And to wake up rested. But anyway, we were just lying there chatting, and we got onto the subject of symbols again. Like, they're so intriguing. What the heck are they? What are symbols? And especially, what are living symbols? So, we talked and talked, and it was a wonderful discussion. But we were starting to get pretty groggy by about 10 or 11, I forget. And the last thing we discussed was the image of Christ as the wounded stag. And then I think we both lost consciousness. Now, perhaps some of you realize that Irish people exaggerate things. Sometimes we lie, although we don't think of it as lies. We think of it as evoking deeper truths. So I'm just saying that as a cautionary note here, and in self-defense, that what I'm going to tell you is not that. I'm not embellishing. I'm going to tell you exactly what happened next. 6 o'clock in the morning, probably about 7-8 hours at the max, from our last thought before losing consciousness, there's a loud banging on our front door. Now, we live on a country road, but it's only about 100 yards from a major highway. And so my wife sprang out of bed, ran to the door, and I heard noise outside. So it's pretty early to be dealing with this. But I heard her voice go by the big window in our bedroom beside our bed, and another feminine voice. And I thought, oh my goodness, what's going on? So I looked out, and there was my woman. My woman. Told you. I'm sorry, I'm very ill. there was my wife in a pink nightie and bare feet and her hair all a mess, running down the road towards the highway with a very distraught, weeping woman. Oh my goodness, something's happened. So I got out of bed, got dressed. I like to guard my dignity. And arrived at the highway 3 or 4 minutes later to find my wife in her pink nightie sitting in the middle of the highway holding a very large antlered stag in her arms that was dying. And she was cradling its head against her heart, stroking it. And it was not yet dead because its eyes were blinking and its chest was heaving, this huge, immense chest. And what's going on here? The lady who had been weeping jumped into a pickup truck and roared off. Later I was to find out she'd hit the deer, was not strong enough to pull it off the highway, and had banged on our door to see if she could get help to do that, because the go-to-work traffic had already begun. And we live on a kind of a blind corner. And sure enough, the go-to-work traffic was in high gear. 100 kilometers an hour is slow at that spot. 60 miles an hour is slow at that spot. So the traffic was roaring, and this was really dangerous. And I said, Sheila, get up. We've got to drag the deer off the highway. And she said, no. Wait. Give it a few minutes. So in the meantime, there were angry people just are roaring around her in both directions, and some shaking their fists, some cursing. You know, she had was, well, maybe part of it was she was a bit of a road hazard, but she slowed up their desperate race to get to work on time. I don't know how long it took. I was guarding traffic, trying to, you know, warn people. Lots of anger, lots of speed, lots of astonishment. Just in parenthesis, imagine if you were driving down a highway early in the morning, a nice ordinary morning, and you come around a corner, and there's There was a middle-aged lady in a pink nightie sitting in the middle of the road holding a deer in her hand. What would you think about that? Would you not pause ever so slightly and say, oh my goodness, what's going on here? You know, no, the desperate lemming-like race continues. The high-speed traffic of modern life continues. I don't think I'm biased. Maybe I am her husband, but I would think if I saw that, I would be utterly astonished and pull over and see if I could help or at least goggle at it as something unique. Now, I don't want you to give the idea that people, you know, that deer die in our arms every day up north, but they certainly don't, and this was a unique experience. But it was teaching me a lot of things on many, many levels about my wife, about the pace at which people live, the desperation people live in myself, all kinds of things were being communicated here. A lull in the traffic. My wife looks at me. The deer blinks its last, blinks, heaves a great sigh, and dies. Doesn't take another. Its head just rests against my wife's breast. She looks at me and she says, all right, now. So together we pulled it off the highway. And later I took it down the road into the forest. Later I was to make the connections. Wait a second, we fell asleep. We fell asleep talking about the dying stag is a symbol of Christ, and we woke up with a dying stag in our arms. What's going on here? Perhaps the statistical odds allow that this kind of coincidence can happen in life, or perhaps for this one little moment in our lives, God was underlining a truth here that creation speaks, that beyond the symbols, beyond the symbol language, there are realities, tangible realities. We could feel the heavy flesh. We could feel its heat. The apostles felt the heat of Christ's hands. The apostles could touch the tears that came down his face. The apostles were fed cooked fish by him. One of the apostles, Thomas, put his fingers into the wound, into the living wound of Christ's side. This is a universe of the Word made flesh. Why is God doing that? Why did he make the world and salvation history go this way? Famous saints, mystics, theologians, holy theologians, have said that all of creation glorifies God. But creation is damaged. Death has entered into the world. And creation in Christ is in a long process of groaning, as St. Paul says, groaning in a great act of being born, really a great act of restoration. Human culture, if it is an integration of truth and beauty and virtue, helps man to read rightly the hidden face of reality. It is a visual gospel, or if it's music, it's an auditory, soul-heart gospel. But whatever the art may be, it is speaking to the soul of man. It is speaking to his heart and mind. It is reminding him that he is more than he thinks he is, that he is not a mechanism, he is not a number, he is not a piece in a machine. I would like to end with just a brief quote from a spiritual writer who I revere greatly. In the year 2000, in March of 2000, gave a talk in Palermo, Italy, to the communion and liberation movement, a faith and culture movement that's very widely spread in Europe and now in North America. He gave a talk on the loss of spiritual fatherhood in the modern age, especially the developed Western nations, the post-Christian nations. He connected it to the atrocities which have occurred, the great crimes against mankind in the 20th century. And he warns in the same talk of new potential crimes against humanity that can occur in the field of bioethics. He connects the attempted annihilation of man at Auschwitz, and he mentions Auschwitz by name, and the new anti-human bioethics, bioengineering, as fundamentally the same thing, the negation of the eternal value of the human person, the rendering him down to the realm of objects. This spiritual writer, the man who gave that talk, said that this is the realm of the beast of Revelation. He says, God is a person, and he looks. When he sees each of us, he sees a person created in the image, in his own image. The beast has a number, according to the book of Revelation. The world of the machine, his phrase, the world of the machine would render man into numbers. The world of the machine contains the very great danger of rendering man into numbers. This, says this spiritual writer, is the realm of the beast of the book of Revelation. The speaker, perhaps some of you may have guessed, is Joseph Cardinal Ratzinger, very not long after Pope Benedict XVI. He is raising basic questions about our civilization, that we ignore at our own peril. He posits the true healing and solution. Fundamentally, we must be restored to our relationship with God as Father. And of course, that is through Jesus Christ, by the power of the Holy Spirit. And from our restoration with the fatherhood of God, will come the restoration of human fatherhood in its many dimensions, spiritual fatherhood. Benedict said, then Cardinal Ratzinger said, that the loss of spiritual fatherhood is the main spiritual crisis of our age. All other crises, all other madness, all other catastrophe flows from that primal break in the flow of relationship of love from the Father to his creatures. Where do we find again this harmony? I believe we find it where we have always found it, through accepting the limitations of our creaturehood by learning to suffer with Christ. And even as we suffer, even as we struggle, we strive to create, we choose to love, we choose to sacrifice. Any father knows, any mother knows, mothers know it easier than we do, we fathers. Without sacrifice, there is no love. Life costs. Life costs sometimes everything. The creation of a culture of life will cost. It will cost, perhaps, everything. Writers, artists, musicians, those gifted with creative faculties and powers must learn to bring these powers before Christ in total submission and humility and allow him to co-create through us, to bear words of life into the world. Our small deeds, this little painting, this little song, which will never be famous, Who cares? If this little painting or this little song or this little story shifts the balance of the world a little, or even shifts the balance of another human life a little, then he has been immensely successful. He has fulfilled his mission. He has given a word of truth and of love that gives life to others. Here is where we are losing most of our battles in the new evangelization, and where we have been losing ground and countless souls for over a generation, and of course much longer. Faith and culture need each other in the new evangelization. It is in culture, the artificial culture of the meta-machine, fueled by money and the lower appetites and manipulation and falsehood and occasional little scraps of good material. It's depriving us of our human inheritance, of our capacity to know who we are. I could go on and on about this aspect of things forever. But I'm absolutely convinced we need great saints. We need great sacrificers as signs to this generation. We need holy priests. We need holy apostles. We need holy consecrated religious. We need a vast army of holy, striving to be holy, consecrated lay people. We need holy parents, people who die, who are willing to die. Here is where I accept to die, to give my family life, no matter what the cost. To hell with being happy here in this world. To hell with success, if it is outside the parameters of God's particular will for my life. Success is not our business. That's God's business. Our business is fidelity to the particular grace of one's calling, be it a stockbroker in Manhattan or a gardener in Ohio or a fisherman in the Arctic. It doesn't matter. What matters is fidelity to grace in your particular state of life. Too long we have counted the cost. We've been counting costs. We've been saying success must be measured before we invest energy and time. And thus, we're losing the soul of a generation. All of which is to say, life demands living words, living flesh and blood, lived in Christ, bearing fruit that will last. This cannot be done without sacrifice. It cannot be done without even at times the experience that one has lost everything, of a failure, of death. And if we are really living in this mystery of the restoration of the world through the cross and resurrection, we will find Jesus precisely there, in the cross, in that much terrified, feared golden gateway, the cross. None of us wants it, but it is immensely fruitful, immensely. And every person I know, creative person, any walk of life, who enters into that mystery with Christ, who dies and allows Christ to bring forth fruit from that dying. Gives life. That's where the new evangelization must go. Money will help. Strategizing sessions will help. It's all good. Networking will help. Knowing the right people will help. But it will accomplish little without the cross. The personal hidden sacrifices and dyings that each of us must invest. This young generation, There's no generation ever been like these people. These people in their 20s. They are so beautiful. They really, really are awesome human beings. But they must be fed good food. They must be fed good cultural food. They must be fed good teaching. But without the culture, without the beauty, without the mystery and wonder which genuine art gives to the truth, and evokes and communicates with the truth, we may lose them too, except that small remnant of heroes that will survive anything. God wants all men to be saved. That is his primary desire. But it's not a mechanism. It's a struggle. If we see culture as yet another component of some kind of package we have to give to the young, we've missed it. We've missed it. It must be living words, not dead letters, not even true dead letters, but living true words. John Paul II, final comment. John Paul II, in his 1999 letter to artists, says this: man does not know himself. He is a mystery to himself. And so the responsibility is upon you, dear artists, to create images and forms and words that give him life and assist him in knowing himself. He can know himself only, says John Paul II, in Jesus Christ. It is Jesus who reveals to us who we truly are, sons and daughters of the Father. But your living words are signs of this. And above all, your lives. This applies to each and every disciple of Jesus, every believer in Jesus. Your lives are the living sign. You are the Word. You are the Word made flesh in Christ. Anyway, what more can I say? Just St. John said it all. The Word was made flesh and dwelt amongst us. And everything else has come from that. And so now I should take my own advice and say no more. Thank you.